Thank you everyone for coming here today. With us we have Commander Greg May. He's the operational section chief for this incident. We have Suzanne Case. She's the chair of the State of Hawaii Department of Land and Natural Resources. And we have Keith Kawaoka. He's the department director for environmental health with the Department of Health. And they will be speaking with you today, kind of giving you guys an overview as to what's transpired so far, how we're going forward, and then we can open it up for some Q&A.
Good afternoon. I'd like to give a brief recap of where we are with this incident. As you recall, on Tuesday, October 10th, around midnight, the commercial fishing vessel Pacific Paradise grounded off Kaimana Beach. There were originally 20 passengers on board the vessel, 20 people in total. During the rescue, all of those folks were accounted for. They were removed from the vessel for safety reasons, and they were transferred to the Department of Customs and Border Protection custody. The following Friday was our first attempt to try to refloat the vessel. That attempt moved the vessel some, but ultimately it remained lodged on the reef. The next day, on Saturday, we went back for a second attempt, and that is when the vessel caught fire. The fire appears to be accidental, and after that incident, we had to take some time to be sure that the fire was completely extinguished and that we were able to safely maneuver around the vessel. The second attempt to refloat the vessel occurred this past Friday, and we were unsuccessful in ultimately refloating the vessel again. The vessel did move, but not enough to dislodge it from the reef. So despite these setbacks, as we move forward, we continue to focus on the safety of the responders and minimizing further damage to the marine environment. And we just appreciate the cooperation that we receive from our partner agencies as we try to deal with this incident. And with that, I would like to open up to any questions.
Let me just add, I want to thank the Coast Guard and the Department of Health for their very collaborative working style together. This has been, obviously nobody likes having a boat on the reef, but it's really important to do this right, and that takes time, and so we need to be patient with it. We want to make sure that everybody is safe. It's a very popular, obviously, swimming spot and surfing spot. It's a fishery replenishment area, boats right on the reef there. And so we want to make sure that as we go along, we have all the information available to make the best decisions possible. So we're working very closely together. We're meeting daily, talking daily, and trying to make sure as we go along, we have current information on the status of the vessel, the status of what's going on underwater. We need good weather to have the clarity to do the underwater assessments, and so we're just taking time to make sure we get it right and work well together to make sure we come up with the best strategies going forward.
Good afternoon. I'd just like to echo what the commander and Suzanne mentioned about the cooperation at all levels of government, both federal, state, and county. Just to name a few, the federal has been with NOAA and Fish and Wildlife Service. The state level has been with not only DLNR, but also with Department of Transportation, University of Hawaii, and at the county level, certainly Honolulu Fire, Honolulu Police, and Ocean Safety. This has been a collaborative effort. There's no easy solutions right now. We've had several attempts. We will try several more attempts to get the vessel off the reef and put it into a safe location. But in order to do that, we need to make sure that everybody works together. We appreciate the public's cooperation in observing the 500-yard safety zone in the area. And at this point, we will still work at viable solutions to remove the vessel. Thank you.
When will your next attempt be made to remove the vessel?
That's a good question. A necessary part of any salvage plan is to do a complete assessment of the hull of the vessel. The vessel is located in a very dynamic area in a surf break, and we've had issues with the surging of the water and water clarity, and have been unable at this point to conduct a complete assessment of the hull. Once that assessment is completed and we are able to get favorable weather conditions, we'll attempt another to remove the vessel.
What about oil and fuel on board the vessel? What can you tell us about what's on board if you have some concerns with coming to oil?
Okay. The exact amount of fuel on board is not known. It is all based on estimates from the crew and the master aboard the vessel. The vessel transited from Honolulu all the way to America and Samoa and back to Honolulu without refueling. Based on the master and crew's estimates, we estimate there were 4,500 gallons of diesel remaining on board the boat. The salver was able to recover approximately 3,000 gallons of that fuel. And any remaining fuel is located in a tank in the engine room that is currently submerged and plugged, and we're unable to access that tank safely at this point.
Would that be one of the concerns that you have about, you know, when you float it, not compromising that so the fuel stays contained?
Absolutely. Yeah, when we try to refloat the vessel, one of the reasons that we want to do an inspection of the hull is to make sure that it can withstand that stress. And we don't want to damage the vessel in the process and have a release of fuel right on Waikiki Beach.
I know that some folks, we have heard some stories anecdotally maybe of folks trying to board the vessel. I know you have a safety zone when you're trying to keep people away. How do you keep them away if you don't have anyone there, unless you do, to stay off the boat? What are you doing?
So there is a safety zone in place, and we would ask that people cooperate with that and not try to approach the vessel for safety reasons. There are random patrols in the area from Coast Guard assets, and we do have security provided by the responsible party, the vessel's ownership, after hours to monitor that situation.
Is the vessel filled with water?
The vessel currently on the reef does have water in it. Several of the compartments are flooded. There is one compartment in the back part of the boat, the aft part of the boat, that is not, and that is providing the little bit of buoyancy that you see in the vessel moving around. But for the most part, most of the spaces on board the boat are filled with water.
Is that contributing to your inability to be able to float the boat to move it?
Sure. The water adds weight to the vessel. So that's our main concern, trying to reduce the total amount of weight that we're trying to move. So when we go to refloat the vessel, a typical practice would be to dewater the vessel, to try to pump that water out to lighten the load and make the job a little bit easier.
Do you have plans to do that, to try to get rid of some of that water using a water pump?
That was the original plan that was in place on Saturday. There were running pumps trying to pump some water off. And I'm sure we'll consider that option in the future.
Is it sitting on a bed of coral now? You guys are confident that you got it away from any damage?
So the vessel is on the reef, but I'll defer to Ms. Case if she has. On the hull?
Yeah.
Sure.
Yeah. The vessel is on the reef right now. It's not moving a lot, so the whatever damage it's caused right on the reef is relatively contained to that area right now. One of the thoughts is that there are bow stabilizers on the vessel. They may have gotten wedged into the reef and making that tug off the reef a lot harder. And we're waiting for good visibility with the swells and the surf to make the water clear so we can do a good assessment of exactly what's happening on the reef that's making it hard to pull off.
How does the billing go for something like this? Owner of vessel has to pay, I'm sure, for the removal of the vessel. But how does that all work out?
Well, I guess I'd have to defer to the Coast Guard on that question.
Yes, sir. The ownership for the vessel has a legal obligation to help resolve this incident. So to date, the vessel owner's insurance company has funded the response. And that is a typical in this situation, that the responsible party has the first attempt to try to fix the situation, and that's what we have here.
How many more tries will it take for a plan B, and what is the plan B?
So plan B, as you call it, is actually being developed right now by the responsible party. They are still leading this. Yeah, so Plan B is in development right now. The responsible party and their chosen salver are developing options to remove the vessel. Obviously, we're going to continue with our efforts until we're successful, and those plans will be evaluated once they're submitted. Key elements of those plans are safety and preventing further damage to the marine environment.
How many attempts, though? How many attempts would that before you get into the, like how many more tries are you going to take before you get to that?
So I think we are at that point now. We're considering other options. We've had two attempts to refloat the vessel that have been ultimately unsuccessful. So that's going to inform our decisions going forward. We'll have to develop a plan that does reduce weight on the vessel, or a plan that may consider trying to lift the vessel rather than pull it.
Is this still at risk for possibly catching on fire again, or is there
several times? Yeah, that's probably not likely. The fire was pretty significant, and most of the combustibles on board were consumed during the fire.
So you have or have not determined whether or not the hull has been breached?
That determination has not been made. Because of water clarity and the inability to be up against the boat with the water surging. We've made several attempts at that, had divers and swimmers in the water to make that evaluation, but we can't say with certainty if the hull has been breached or not.
Is there leakage of any sort?
So we've continued to monitor the area for any signs of pollution or marine debris or impact to wildlife. None of those things have occurred to date. We've had random overflights, we've had folks on the water, we've had folks on the beach. There have been no reports of pollution to date.
Well, there was diesel that leaked out, or some sort of red fluid that leaked out on the day of the first fire, the Saturday before last. And it was estimated from your Coast Guard spokesperson that was diesel fuel. Were any tests taken to see if that was in fact diesel?
So indications are that was probably diesel, red dye diesel that is used in this industry. When the vessel shifted, that most likely happened as the vessel moved and it came out through a fuel vent and what we call burped and created that discharge in the water. Those vents have since been plugged, so we don't anticipate that happening again. And we have done water quality sampling in the area, and I'm pleased to report that there have been no detection of petroleum hydrocarbons in the water, and there's been no pollution detected in the area.
When the ship does eventually become dislodged, where do you plan on taking that ship after?
At this point, the disposal of the ship is ultimately still up in the air. We don't have a definitive plan for that. One option could be to dispose of the vessel in deep water. Another option could be to cut the vessel up in place. There are many options on the table, and we haven't settled on a definitive plan. We're waiting for that plan to be submitted by the responsible party.
Okay.